All right, let's call the special meeting of the Niles Public Library District Board of Trustees to order. It is 7:00 PM on Thursday, April 28th, 2016. Cindy, please take a roll.
Karen?
Here.
Carolyn?
Here.
Barbara?
Previous excuse.
Patty?
Here.
Linda?
Here.
Tim?
Here.
Okay, please stand for the Pledge Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do I have a motion to approve the hiring of Donna E. Fletcher, Inc. for strategic planning consultant not to exceed $34,500? Motion?
I'll make the motion. I think the motion first.
Right.
Second? I didn't make the second, no. I'll make a second.
So first we'll have Donna do her presentation, then we'll have discussion. So Donna, thanks for coming to speak with us. We have a lot on our agenda tonight, so we are going to try to finish this by 7:20. Do we have a chair for Donna?
Yeah, well, yeah, and also my colleague Larry Hammond is here as well.
Okay, all right.
Talk to you.
All right, and Larry. Did you want a seat, two seats?
Two seats would be great.
Okay, we can pull. So Donna Fletcher and then Larry.
Larry Hammond, right. We met with Susan earlier this week and we talked quite a bit about the proposal, et cetera. And she asked us to come and just talk to you a little bit about ourselves and what we're thinking. So I'll start and then my colleague Larry will continue. And very much we thank you for inviting us so we can answer questions you have or need more information. It's absolutely fine. A little bit of my history. I grew up actually in New York State in the Hudson Valley. By the time I was in first grade, I loved reading books, and I was forever asking my parents to take me to our library. Now catch this, this library was in the cellar of an old elementary school. But nonetheless, I got books, and somehow my father ended up being a trustee in this teeny little library for a number of years he was doing that. So always libraries in our houses. After I graduated from college, I moved here in Chicago to work at Leo Burnett Advertising, which is a well-known and an excellent advertising agency. And frankly, what I majored in college wasn't exactly applicable to this, but nonetheless, they hired me, and it was a fantastic place, and I learned all about marketing and how to conduct research. For new products and advertising. And I worked on things like, depending on how old you are, you will or will not know some of these. Charlie the Tuna, Morris the Cat, Kellogg's Frosted Flakes, I can't believe everybody knows what that is, and Pillsbury Refrigerated Dough, made all kinds of crazy things. New products, I had to do that for a while, which was one of those was making refrigerated pizza dough. And then also worked a lot on getting new business. So as time went on, this was all well and good, but I decided to leave and create my own business, which what I wanted to do was work with corporations who needed really good market research, which is what I learned at Leo Burnett. And what I learned about was focus groups, and individual interviews, and surveys. That worked out pretty well, and I had moved to Highland Park by that time, so I joined Rotary and became friendly with another Rotarian. And guess what? She was the library director in Highland Park. So I got to know her, and the next thing I knew, she asked me, would you like to be a trustee? So I agreed and spent 6 years on the board, 2000 to 2006. And actually, I was 2 years as president. Very interesting thing, and that's what really got me involved in libraries. So, how did I become interested specifically in libraries as clients for market research and strategic planning? Well, at the library, we had had to hire a consultant. We were doing a direct research. She was very good. And after one of our meetings, she said, you know things about research, don't you? Yes. Well, could you do them for a public library? Well, of course, it's no different, really, if you know the skills. So that's sort of how I got involved much more with libraries rather than the corporate world. So for the past 10 years, I've mainly serviced libraries in research, marketing, and strategic planning. We've worked with more than 30 public libraries, and we've completed at least, again, more than 50 research projects and 20 strategic plans. So we're pretty familiar with this stuff by now. But every library is different, and we always take that into our thinking. There's not one way to do everything, and we're very flexible on that. Other things I got involved in is this soon-to-be-famous Illinois Author Project that's been ongoing for 3 years here in Illinois, and it's about, I don't know if any of you are familiar with it, but the project is to find talented, quality authors who want to self-publish their book. And we've had 3 years of it. It's been extremely successful. If you ever want to hear more about it, I'd be happy to tell it to you. Just as an interesting fact, over 30% of books sold on Amazon are self-published. So it's a big category that libraries have to think about. At any rate, we were so successful, we filed a we actually received the 2015 Cotton Dana Award, that's for public relations, which actually we were given $10,000 to give them, we're using that to go on with this project. And guess what? Now I'm back on the Highland Park Library Board because the mayor changed. And she knew me and knew I was very interested in libraries and knew quite a bit about it. She said, could you please go back on the board? So, of course, I said yes. So I'm back on the board. But let's go talk a little bit more about strategic planning, what's different and important about how we do it. The big thing is we are adamant, frankly, that we do conduct research and that we do it in a way that's not biased. And we use our professional knowledge to develop all our survey questionnaires. And what we're trying to do for the questions is to find out what the community needs, okay, and what they want. Two big things. It's really, obviously you're funded by the community, so we need to know what they want and what they need. And we do very reliable research. It takes somewhat of a longer time than you might like, but it gets done, and the results are worth it. And we can show you endless ones that we've done that have been extremely important in creating a good strategic plan. We also, believe me, we don't just do surveys, but for example, we also sometimes do telephone interviews among people who finish the questionnaires, okay, the survey. And they've sort of written little things in that you're like, I wonder what they really mean by that. And we ask them if we get their name and phone number, if they'd be willing to participate in it. I just did this a couple weeks ago. And it was phenomenal what we learned. We knew quite a bit about the library and thought, that what they were doing in the youth services was really good. Well, turns out there were some rough spots. So I was meeting with this group few days ago, they took it very seriously and started saying, we can do this, that, great. So that kind of thing we can do with the research. And another thing we get involved in quite often with strategic planning is non-users. Why are they non-users? Who are they? Why don't they use the library? And we have, over the years, figured out
you want that information, you better go where these people are, which is not the library, clearly. So we've done it several times when we go off-site, and have a specific, particular questionnaire that really focuses on why they don't go or why they use the library. And, you know, if you go to places, it all depends on your community, but one I worked with, you know, they were at the laundromat, they were at the Latino grocery store, and so on and so forth, 10 different places. It was amazingly, I mean, it really got the information we needed. That's might be something that you want to do as well. And as all this went on with non-users, I ended up creating a program about what I call the Elusive Library Non-User, which ended up being presented at American Library Association's conference, ILA, and PLA. So that was back in 2013 or 14. But I still get requests for the PowerPoint slides, so if you ever want them, happy to provide them. But at any rate, having this information will greatly inform this strategic plan. And as I said, it's going to be based on what the community needs and wants. And will help the library to define its role and create a plan with goals and activities that will support all of this. So that's a little bit for now. Larry, you want to go on?
Okay. a little bit about my background. For my entire adult life, working life, I've done surveys. I've never done anything else, and I've never been interested in doing anything else. The first survey I ever worked on was in 1958, so that means that I've been doing them for 58 years. And that was at a company called Market Facts, which at the time was the largest company in the Midwest, research company in the Midwest. We were on LaSalle Street, had 54 people, I remember that very clearly, and I went to work for them. At the time, I was in graduate school at Northwestern, and had a wife and a baby, and I needed to get a job, so I went there and started doing surveys. I really liked it, really enjoyed it. And in 1961, 3 years later, through a contact that I had with Market Facts, working on survey, and a reference, I interviewed a Leo Burnett company, the same company that Donna worked at many, many years before Donna. I went to work as a research analyst, and I left as a research manager in 1965. So I was at Burnett 4 years. I was a research manager on several accounts. The ones that kept me most busy Allstate, a company called Pure Oil, which is now became Union Oil, I don't know what they're called now, and then Starkist Tuna. Used to go out to Los Angeles on that. In 65, I left Burnett and went to work with a company called the Research Guild, which is no longer in business. It was a medium-sized company, had about 20 employees. And in 68, 3 years after I joined the firm, I became research director. Now, I was running the firm, but I didn't have any equity in the firm. I was a sole proprietor, and he wasn't interested in giving up that position. So in 1970, I left Research Guild, and I founded my own company with a partner. Her name is Ruth Campbell, and she was an employee also of Research Guild. We both left to start our own company. That was in 1970, and we're still in business. She is still my partner after all these years. Probably may well be the longest partnership, one of the longest partnerships for all those years in the entire country. We still do studies. I have worked on about 1,400 surveys, 1,400 different surveys. over those 58 years, for about 125 to 150 different companies or organizations, mostly middle-sized and large companies. And I was just jotting down, I just quickly read the companies I've worked for: Sears, Abbott, McDonald's, General Mills, Discover Card, Allstate, 7-Eleven, Harris Bank, Quaker Oats, Starkist Tuna, Illinois Lottery, People's Gas, and Gallo Wine. And I could name twice that number. Those are the better-known ones. What happened to us, Ruth and me, was that we essentially aged out of the business. This was in the '60s when this started, and client-supplier relationships had a strong social component. It was the Mad Men era, that's what, you know, the martini lunches and all that. And we found that as the years went by, we joked that as we got older, our clients stayed, most research people and corporations are on the young side. And we found increasingly they were old enough to be their parents, that we had lunch with these people. Then as the years went by, it got to the point where we were old enough to be their grandparents. So gradually, the business shrunk. Our clients retired and died. And the Burnett people that I worked with, I don't think very many of them are alive anymore, because I was the youngest manager by far in the department. I was in my mid-20s, and the average age was in the mid-30s. So we aged out. What was left, it was very fortuitous, I started working with Donna and started doing library surveys, and we've done a bunch of surveys over the last 10 years. And I'd like to talk a little bit about the survey in terms of what we've proposed. We're doing 1,000 interviews, we've proposed 1,000 interviews. 500 of the interviews are in the library, and we would interview over a 10-day period. People, as they enter the library, would be invited to participate. And then it includes 2 weekends. We'd also propose 500 interviews in off-site locations, public gathering places, to get at the non-use, people who are not using libraries. You're not, as Donna said, you're not going to find non-users in the library. There are five qualities that I briefly want to touch on that set us apart from other consultants in this area. One is that we rely heavily on research for strategic planning. It is not uncommon for a survey to be proposed by a consultant for strategic planning. Very often, the survey's over here, and the strategic plan's over here, and there is no linkage between the two. But we design surveys for the two to be closely linked. In fact, we design surveys with strategic planning in mind. And we have, for example, developed a question, essentially a proprietary question, no one else uses it, that gets at broad strategic initiatives. And we broach that subject with patrons and assess that. So our surveys are designed for strategic planning. Second, our surveys are quantitative, 1,000 interviews. They are not qualitative. They do not employ focus groups. Focus groups are popular in libraries. They don't work well in libraries for various reasons. You tend to end up with friends in the library, and you don't learn much. Also, libraries, and I don't think necessarily library people recognize this, but libraries are incredibly complex service organizations. I used to think that banks were complex and multi-service, but there are 10 times more services offered by the average library than the average retail bank. They're very complex, and they have a great many segments of patrons, for example. To represent those people in a focus group is impossible, physically impossible. You'd have to do 10 groups, and 10 groups would be so costly. So they don't work for that reason. In our surveys, we look at light users, heavy users, medium users, we look at seniors, we look at people with children in different age groups, we look at all of these segments, and to do that, you can't do it qualitatively. You couldn't compose the groups to cover all those segments. The third point is that we are as comprehensive as possible. Surveys in libraries tend to be short. They're brief. Our in library patron survey is 6 full pages, and it's a 10 to 12 minute interview, and you can cover a lot in 10 to 12 minutes. We are as comprehensive as possible because we recognize the complexity of the library. So we have, for example, ratings of different services that the library offers. And currently we're doing about 30, we have a 10-point scale we use. We have about 30 different features in the library that we have rated. We rate collections, DVDs, bestsellers, other adult books, children's books, the website, the newsletter, the staff, the study environment or work environment in the library. And we select these items from about 60 that we've used for different libraries. And your library would have input on some of those. Some of them are standard. They're in every survey we do. So we're as comprehensive as possible. You will, if we do the survey for you, some of the findings will confirm what you knew already, confirm your opinions, your speculations, your understanding of the library. That always happens. You'll see a finding, say, yeah, that's consistent. And that kind of validates your feeling. But I guarantee you that the survey will reveal things that you have not expected. I guarantee that happens always. I'll give you a particular example of a survey we just finished. One of the collections or the services we evaluated is called Tumble Books. Tumble Books for Children. I don't know if you guys have it or not. And in this particular library, they said they in talking before the survey, staff said Tumble Books are extremely popular in the library. Okay. We did the survey. And we found that among people with children of Tumble Book age, only 10% were even aware of Tumble Books. And she said, how could this, the staff person said, how could this be? Because it's a very popular program. It's in the collections. I said, because you've got a tiny group of people using it over and over and over again. Once you publicize it, and as a result of the survey, they're going to publicize it, you will see this explode in terms of usage. No expectation that was actually 10%. It was for the few people aware of it, it was very well rated, but no one knew about it, so publicized it. Okay. So you will learn things that you don't know. The only way you can do that is to do a survey. The only way you can do that is to get outside the library environment, away from the staff, and get input from the community. Finally, we differ in another important respect. On some key measures that we have, that we use in every survey or nearly every survey, we can show you how your library compares with other libraries. For example, we measure overall satisfaction with the library. And we have this recent study we completed. That particular measure is a key measure that we use, and one of the key measures. We were able to compare that, the outcome of that measure for that library for 19 other Illinois libraries, or 20 libraries, and we could tell them how they fared against other libraries. That's relevant because you're not in a contest particularly, but it helps you evaluate how well you're doing or how you're not doing well when you can look at your data versus other libraries. So,
and in what factors you compare against other libraries?
For the measure, for percent with high satisfaction.
What are the, did you break down various factors that we compare against in those other libraries?
What are you saying in general?
In general. This particular measure was general satisfaction.
Oh, I understand. I thought maybe categories or something.
Yeah. And this library happened to rank, we don't release the names of the libraries, but happened to rank fourth out of 19. ranking libraries, they're very strong library in that measure. But we had other measures. The library was rather weak in adult programming, and it was rather weak in popular materials, bestseller.
Okay, I guess that's what I was getting at. Yeah, those categories, is that part of the planning committee?
Right.
That you break those down?
So maybe if we want to go around, you have a couple questions, and we can have a discussion.
Sure.
Karen, do you want to start, do you have any questions?
Boy, I do.
Go ahead.
So in your proposal here, you mentioned several different types of documents, I'm not sure, how many different documents do you refer to creating as part of your assessment of what the community wants? Because you refer to a survey, you refer to a questionnaire. How many different documents are there that you're preparing?
Well, what?
And then telephone interviews separate to?
Yeah, well.
We have two questionnaires.
Okay.
We have a questionnaire with patrons.
Is that the one, the six-page one that you pass out in the library?
And we have a shorter questionnaire in the public gathering places.
All right.
To get it non-use, that's probably 3 pages, it's shorter.
Okay, and you propose collecting or distributing 500 of each of those?
Yes.
And now, what's your usual collection rate when you hand out 500 questionnaires in the library? How many do you usually get back?
Over 90%.
And how about off-site, how many?
Off-site, we get virtually 100%, because they either accept the questionnaire or they don't. It's not.
You don't put them in a pile anywhere.
We don't put them in a pile.
All right, so someone has to be there.
Oh, yeah, they have to be.
And that would be one of our staff members, is that right?
In the library, yes.
What about off-site?
It would be a staff member as well.
All right, and what about, so is the, when you're using the word survey and questionnaire, that's the same thing, it's like you're talking about the same thing.
Survey and questionnaire.
Okay, all right. And the telephone interviews, Donnie, you propose to do that, is that right? How many of those would you do?
I would do it too.
Okay. How many of those would you do?
20.
20?
Mm-hmm.
And those are just done for follow-up in areas that we're not clear on, additional programming.
You mean follow-up to the questionnaire slash survey?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so, based on that, it seems like you would be gathering information from, at most, about 1,000 people, is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, all right.
1,020.
Well, but the follow-up are people you already talked to, right?
I would talk to them a second time, it's a different interview.
Okay, all right. Is there any other way that you're getting information from people who are not employees or board members?
No, those are the two sources.
Those are the sources, yeah.
Okay, all right.
Well, that's not true, there's also stakeholders that we interview as well.
Okay, and where are the stakeholders?
It's bottom of page three.
Three? Three?
Three.
Oh, there are three, okay.
There are three, yeah.
Okay. Okay, so those are the machines.
Right.
And who do you designate as being stakeholders, who are those people?
Well, it can be any, it can be all kinds of things, it can be educators, it's all people have a role in the community, okay? So it could be something with schools. Often we talk to, it all depends on your town, or your village, district, right? It can be that, it can be, I talked to somebody, chain of commerce, I usually end up having to talk to, what else did I just do?
School people.
Social services, park districts, you know, broad. And it's really, you know, we'll work with the planning committee, figure out who you'd like to talk to. And obviously, you're gonna know more about it than we do. Even though I don't live too far from here, it's still always different in each community.
All right. Have you used these types of questionnaires, surveys with other libraries in the past?
Oh, yeah, over 50, yeah.
Okay, so you pretty much got it developed already?
Yeah, but we make changes all the time, things, you know, the world is changing too, so some of the things we asked 10 years ago aren't terribly relevant. You know, all the e-materials are taking more and more of a questionnaire, so.
All right, and then you do two sessions in-house with our staff, is that right?
That's, yep.
Okay. And how many staff members would you usually meet with?
It could be any number. I mean, it could be anything from 10 to 30. I mean, I've done it various ways. It just sort of depends on what your staffing is and what you want.
And how long does that last?
I put it in 2 hours, I think, 2 to 3 hours.
Each or altogether?
Each.
Each.
Like you do one in the morning, one in the afternoon.
Okay.
I mean, again, it just depends what's going to work for the library. And because I'm, as I said, because I'm pretty close by, I can do it all in one day or do it in 2 days. Doesn't matter.
But you're in Highland Park, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm sorry, where are you from?
Deerfield.
Deerfield, okay.
It's a real commute to get to this house.
I may have another question, but I don't want to hold things up, so perhaps someone else would like to ask questions.
It's okay. Your questions are a lot of our questions.
Fine, I will defer to someone else who wants to ask a few things.
I have a few.
Patty, do you want to go? I'll just go around.
Not that I can think of right at the moment.
Okay.
I think she talked.
So we create a planning committee. It sounds like the first step. And about how many people do you normally think are on that committee? And who are those people?
Okay, generally, I would say, it all depends on the size of the library. But I think in your situation, you know, say roughly 10 to 12 people.
Oh.
And it would.
So you want a committee that doesn't actually do anything and make any decisions, so you have 12 people?
No. I can handle that.
And how do you meet with planning, I assume you meet with planning committee? And how many times is like the planning committee that you meet with them?
I think it's 3 or 4 times.
Okay.
Yeah. And again, that's flexible. It's not like I have to get on the airplane to get there.
And who do you generally recommend to be on the board?
Well, usually managers, do you call managers?
Yeah, well, we have managers and supervisors.
Yes, those are generally the area you want. But, you know, there are always exceptions to that too, so.
Your surveys, why don't you have a link on the website for doing like an email type survey?
We do email surveys. They're expensive.
Really?
They're more expensive. But I have nothing cheap about.
Huh, okay. It seemed like it would almost be easier if you open up a link and have the survey and email to the library.
Much better participation rates.
You'd be surprised.
Okay. See, that's why you do what you do. I don't. Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
Wait, Carol.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, go ahead. You answered half my question.
I know. When you say survey, you know, surveys are expensive. Are you talking like Survey Monkey, one of those programs?
No, we don't use Survey Monkey. Survey Monkey is inadequate to the task.
Okay, that's all I want.
That's fine. I had a couple of questions that Karen didn't ask. You mentioned focus groups that you do or do not utilize them?
Like, we've done thousands, but it doesn't work well in the library world. Okay? The reason is, it's for several reasons, but in the corporate world, if you want to do focus groups, you hire a recruiter to get the people you need, the types of people. Okay, and it's expensive. Libraries, I mean, it's, I haven't done it in a while, but you would be paying, probably $150 per person they could find. And they would expect an incentive. That's usually money too.
So what would you consider a focus group for a library that we would not want to?
Well, what some libraries do is they decide they want it, and so they recruit, you know, basically people they know who come in the library. And that's, as Larry said, you're getting friends of the library. It's not, you know, it's not a broad spectrum at all.
So that's your definition of a focus group, but it also sounds like 50% of the surveys will be given to the people of the library that come to the library. So those patrons too could be friends of the library. So we're dipping into the same group, right, but for a different reason?
No, it's quite different. I mean, because we're, what we do with the, we hand out the questionnaires in the library. And it's, we do it at different times of the day, different days, so you get a more, you know, a span of different types of folks.
Yeah, the only thing about, I've done a lot of focus groups, both of us have. For several years, that's all I did, all over the country. And certain, focus groups have their place. They are not good, it's not a good methodology for libraries. For the reasons that Donna cited, you tend to get people who are really deeply into the library. But there are other reasons. This type of input from the community essentially demands a large sample of people, because you have so many segments of people. If you were to do focus groups and try to represent all the different segments, you'd have 10, 12 groups.
I'm sure.
Which would be terribly expensive. And this is not generally understood. Focus groups are misused in general. They are very good at developing ideas. You can go out and do two groups, and you do a third group, you're not at all sure the third group is going to say anything that's similar to the first two groups. In other words, the technique is qualitative, it's not quantitative, it's not predictive, and it statistically it's not reliable. It's not a good device for libraries.
Okay, well thank you for that. I have another question, unbiased research. What types of questions do you consider unbiased research? What questions is that about?
Well, it's how you write the questions.
Yeah.
I mean, you might explain it.
Like, what would be a typical unbiased question?
Well, it'd be easier to.
And then one of the questionnaires, right?
I'm trying to think of a biased question. We don't ask them, so they don't come to mind immediately. Why that word was used?
I don't either. I think it's because when you're doing a survey and are doing it correctly, you don't get a bias. You've got this broad spectrum of people. That's what it is.
So what's a biased question?
Well,
I'm just trying to get a feel for what you don't use. So what is it that you do use? I'm just looking for an example.
Well, I can tell you the areas we go into very easily.
Well, I'm more concerned about the questions. If you're going to be out into the public, you know, 500 people are going to come in contact with one of our staff, and they'll be giving them questionnaires.
Right.
What would be one of those questions they would be asking?
All right, I'll give you some.
Yeah.
One question we ask is, all things considered, how satisfied are you with the library? Entirely satisfied? Satisfied for the most part, but not entirely, or not satisfied? Take your choice. Unbiased question.
So the questions are rather general?
That one is.
Yeah.
Another one is, on a 10-point scale, where 10 equals very good and 1 equals poor, how would you rate your children's books? On the same scale, how would you rate the website? On the same scale, the whole 30.
Okay. Okay,
that's
thank
another.
You.
Yeah.
Right, then, all right, let's see what else. You said that you would locate non-users. How would you go about locating non-users?
You go out in the community and you distribute questionnaires at public gathering places, yet to be determined, and you ask them whether our definition of non-use is someone who has not been to the library in the past year. That's how we define it.
So and how would you know where to go to find those people?
They're public.
In a public place.
We do it all the time. You can go to restaurants, you can go to senior centers.
Laundromat,
any place people gather. The alternative to it is methodology. The only quote scientific way to get at non-users is a telephone survey. Because all other surveys are opt-in, and you don't get non-users agreeing to be interviewed about something they're not interested in.
How would you come up with a telephone base to do that?
Telephone surveys, you can buy sample.
Samples for our area, is that what that is?
Yeah, terribly expensive. Just some monster cost. This is an expedient, less costly way to gather information. And you're searching for non-users, but people are asked in the questionnaire, it's a handout questionnaire, and there'll be three or four questions on it. One of them is, have you been visited the library building in the past year? If they say no, we ask them why, what reasons do you have for not coming? And then we tabulate the answers to the question. If they say yes, we actually have a few questions. Again, we ask that satisfaction question and a couple other questions, for not, and then demographics.
Okay, thank you. I have a question about the in-house meeting that you'll have with staff. There's two of them, approximately 2 hours. And if that's in here, I didn't read your handout, so I apologize. But what type of questions would you be asking our staff?
You need to read this page because it's.
I'll take whatever you can give me. Just two ideas would be great.
Well, it's about it's basically to get them sort of thinking out of the box. Well, you set up an issue or a problem. How can the library be innovative? How can the library better engage the community? And you put them into little teams, and they write, and then they go around the room and rotate it, and they keep going on and on. But it's a little more complicated than that, but that's one way.
So is it a workshop
to
teach our staff how to be more innovative?
Or? No, it's just sort of get them thinking more broadly and just come up with new ideas.
Okay, great, thank you. And then I have another question. The planning committee would also consist of staff? Is only staff or other people?
It's to be determined.
Is the planning committee people who bring ideas to you, or are they a group of people you bring ideas to them?
Well, good question. We are helping them get the information to figure out what the plan should be. Okay, they're involved in it, we're involved in it.
Okay. All right, I think that's all I have. Thank you.
Sure.
I just have one question. Okay, so you're saying you're going out to the different areas in the community. Are we looking for people who are actual taxpayers, or just anyone out in the community? Or how do we determine who we're actually?
Anybody in your district.
So are we saying, are you in the Niles Public Library District? Is that one of the questions?
Well, they, I think you go to locations where
where people would be most likely local from it. Like if you're in a laundromat, most likely you're from that area. That's why you're saying that's kind of a good venue to go to. Because a restaurant could be anyone from anywhere. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I'm just saying.
Yeah, but like a small grocery store would also be one that.
Right, because I'm not as interested in, not that, I mean, yes, we want to know about the communities, what they're, but I really want to know what our taxpayers want because it's their money.
That's right.
So that's true. You know, as a board member, that would be my focus. So. I guess is that one of the questions on that? That would be, are you in this district?
And they may or may not know the answer to that.
Well, one question, we did this recently in Oklahoma. You established that people are at least aware of the library, of its existence. If you get someone, people say, I've never heard of the library, you know, the library, you don't bother talking to them because they're not. There are people who potentially are patrons, but they don't happen to. That's one question that we start out with. If they're not familiar, then we don't get into the interview.
I think everything else has been answered with everyone else. You got more, Karen?
Just in terms of these off-site interviews, again, this our staff have to go out and do this, right? And do they have to pick the places to go to also?
Well, this would be some of the planning committee would work on. What would be the places to go? Presumably they know this area.
All right. And then you're going to do some, or 20 follow-up interviews based on those. And how do you choose which ones you're going to call?
Well, because it depends what they've written on the questionnaire.
Okay.
And we also ask them would you be willing to do a telephone interview? Yes, no, and get their phone number.
We ask everybody.
Right, and remind me to make sure I get their email as well.
And how long are these follow-up telephone calls?
It can be anything, generally it's about 5 to 10 minutes, but sometimes you get into, you know, deeper, you know, and they want to talk and they're saying interesting things, I just go on with it to maybe 20 minutes.
Thank you.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
On page 12, you have, or I'm sorry, your page, you have the timetable. So the week, it says pre-1 and then 1-1-1-1-1.
Yeah.
Is that all the same week?
Yeah.
It's all the same.
You know, but this is a possibility, right? It may not really happen, but it's sort of giving you an idea.
I was just trying to, so you think this is about a 4.5 month process?
I'd say, you know, like, probably to be safer, I'd say 5 months, but, you know, it just depends on the time of the year.
Oh, sure.
You know, see if we have tornadoes here, I don't know. Don't let one of my clients, but not too bad. Anything else? Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thanks for inviting us.
Thank you very much.
I'm still trying to think of a biased question. We give instructions for the staff members who are distributing, or your volunteers, sometimes volunteers, sometimes staff members, for the in-laboratory. And we always have a comment in there. Don't ask them to invite them to participate in the survey, but don't say something like, now's your chance to tell us what you really like about the survey. That would be extremely biasing. That's a biasing context. Or conversely, now is your chance to vent about the library, what you don't like about it. So that would be context part. I'm still trying to think of a biased question. We don't ask us. They don't come to life. So it was a word we shouldn't have used. Okay.
And so then we'll just have discussion. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay. So discussion.
I have some concerns about the cost. I think it would be helpful and useful to have professional assistance in doing this, but I do have some concerns about the cost, particularly since it sounds like our staff is going to
doing
be doing
all
a lot of the
Should
work.
We maybe
here.
Have asked them if there was a
Well, I think the majority of the work is actually doing the analysis on the results of the survey, because when you're dealing with 1,000 different things, when we've had things in the past, our past surveys and things like that, you basically just get a list of people's comments, and it's like, that's interesting, but it's not analyzed in any way, it's not digested, it doesn't help you pick out themes, and then we didn't have like follow-up interviews with people to get more deeply into some of the things that come up in the course of filling out the surveys. So that was one of the things that, I think that's what his particular expertise is doing the actual analysis on it. And that's what I saw at Lincolnwood, is the binder that she had was, you know, like that, of information that he had pulled out of those surveys and analyzed, and, you know, she had the raw data, and she also had then the synthesized, analyzed data with his results, his conclusions from what the information was.
But I don't know when our staff are going to go out and do all this.
Staff or volunteers, and I'm definitely thinking volunteers myself. I'm not happy about the idea of sending staff out to spend that much time. And I think volunteers would do a better job in some ways, too. And Cindy has a very nice army of volunteers these days. So.
Oh, that's right, you do.
That's,
yeah,
that's,
we do.
You
know,
excellent volunteer corps.
Because it sounds like it would take, with the amount of surveys, it sounds like it would take a lot of hours. Just waiting in certain locations at different times to find people that you can give the surveys to.
But then on the other hand, that's the people we need to talk with and really get information.
Oh, no, and I'm not arguing that point at all.
I know, it's like kind of like a catch-22. Because it's like that's the information we want, but yet...
Yeah.
Holy cow, do we want our people out there in man hour
I wasn't even thinking volunteers.
Yeah, I'm like, okay, that's like, okay.
But these volunteers have to really know that it's a big job they're taking on too, to make sure that they know what they're getting into.
There would be some training for the volunteers.
Well, I think too, because then we have to worry about that bias component too. Oh, what do you have to say great about the light? You know what I mean? There's your bias. Exactly. There was actually a good example of that. Oh, what you hate about the, you know, just kind of,
Well, they're going to be using a fixed survey.
Right, but how do they
present it?
How do you present it? That's the whole thing. So you almost have to have a script.
Right.
For them to present it so that it's consistent and not biased.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if, you know, just as we're talking about it, go ahead, Karen.
Well, again, I just have some concerns about the other costs. So they're making follow-up phone calls, but looking at that budget on page R16 or 11, you work it out, it's $200 for a phone call.
Yeah.
You know, they're coming in to meet with their staff. You work it out, it's $1,500 for 2 to 3 hours. The survey development analysis and report, survey development, it seems like their surveys should be sort of already mostly developed if they've been doing a lot of them. Analysis and report, I don't know. Does that take 16,000? I don't know. I guess I'm just wondering, are there...
How much actual time they're spending?
Yeah, I don't know.
That would be interesting.
And I'm just wondering, are there other competitors out there that...
The ones that I talked to did more of the focus group kind of things. They just, it was... you remember when you were interviewing the library director search consultants, and there was the one guy in Texas that he did telephone surveys, but that was an $81,000 proposal. So that kind of research is really very expensive. So there probably are other people outside of the library world, but the people inside the library world that do this kind of thing are just doing your kind of, you know, the things that don't dig in deep. And so I was hoping that we would do something that really gave us a lot more data than we got last time. The other ones, you know, you invite in all the educators and ask them a few questions, give them some breakfast rolls, and they go out the door, and that's your research. And that, to me, is that's not real research.
Well, that's what she's doing. She's only going to contact a few stakeholders.
Well, we would tell her who we want.
I know, but only 20 people.
Yeah.
That's frightening.
But that's only a small bit of
what
they're
planning.
Doing.
That's part of the planning committee, though. Right?
Overall, 1,000 people will be questioned. We have 60,000 people that reside in this Niles Public Library District. 1,000, it's not even worth the time and energy to do that. What are we going to learn? In focus groups, in my opinion, are ethnicities, areas, things we need to become well aware of. They don't seem to be on the same page as the Niles Library. I know she's from Highland Park. I don't know what libraries they've already had their questionnaires with. But what makes us think questionnaires in Highland Park would fit us? I mean, what do they know about us? I mean, our staff knows a lot more about our population than they do. I think it's extremely costly, and I don't see what you're getting out of it. I'm also concerned the information she's looking at. Don't we already pay that consortium of ours to tell us about books and this and that and what's going on? Don't you guys pay a ton of money analyzing what books are good? Isn't that what all your supervisors do? Figure out what the best picks are, what are the best videos? We don't need her to delve into that.
What I think her point is that she's asking the people, are we doing a good job of what we're doing?
But we've already asked the people if we were doing a good job when we hired the Matrix consultants. They told us a lot that we were doing and how we reached out or who we didn't reach out to.
But he didn't talk to anybody in the community.
He gave you information already. She's only going to touch on 1,000 people. If we're going to utilize our staff, we should be able to do a much better job. What are we going to learn from 1,000 people? We're still not going to reach the pockets way in the corner.
Actually, I disagree, because that is how you do take a scope and you take a snapshot of what's happening. You can't possibly ever interview every That's how all surveys, all of us, you take a snapshot.
Well, maybe a survey is the wrong terminology. I thought we were so concerned about all these groups that we don't reach out to. If they go to Golf Mill, what, 10% of the people that go there are library patrons? We already have so many non-residents coming here.
Well, but the thing is, too, I mean, but not just that. I mean, I think the one component, too, is important that you have a board member on there. I mean, that was on there, I think that's important.
Doesn't mean anything. I'm not impressed with their process. I'm not impressed that they've been doing this for 58 years. I'm sure there are people who are more connected with today's issues. They seem to have a long history, but they couldn't even answer questions about what they're telling me they're going to do. It's their terminology. I didn't make this up. So it sounds like they definitely have a skit that they read to everyone, but I don't see how it will relate to the issues in our library and where I thought we were going based on, you know, our strategic plan we've been talking about all year. She definitely didn't answer any questions. And I think for $34,000, wow, it's a waste. I would consider consulting others.
Carolyn, I do agree that this is a lot of money. There's no denying it's a lot of money. And I'm not saying we should put down the money. I think, if anything, we should discuss this at length. But I read the material, and I did see where it did talk about going through the group, the library, and getting their information they need for their surveys through talking to the staff and people at the library and getting their ideas of what we think, and places, not Golf Mill, but places we think as a community would be good places for focus groups. I personally did not hear or even begin to think that they were talking Golf Mill, because if you read this, they talked about going to senior centers, daycare centers, they talked about going to places where they would food pantries, they talked about going to schools. They didn't mention giant shopping centers. So I personally don't view this in that regard the same way you do.
But in terms of being not all Niles patrons, the senior center is not Niles. There are people from every suburb around here. Daycare centers, you drop your kid off at a daycare center that's near your place of employment. It has nothing to do with Niles. So, I mean, those in themselves aren't very sound suggestions. I mean, I still think the sample is way too small for the population. That's just my opinion.
I guess there's a cost, a balance always with how many samples you're going to get. And I guess if you increase the number of the samples, then you're going to have to increase the cost. There's
if you go through them, you can consider other people who can do this for you, not this costly,
so
maybe use different approaches.
How many did you consider?
I have proposals from two more, and there was a third one who I know to do basically the same thing as the other two. So I still could get her, but it's still going to come in at a significantly lower cost. But if you don't think that this is going to give you enough information, nothing that they're going to do is going to give you anything.
And what are their samples? 1,000?
They aren't surveying at all. They're doing focus groups.
Okay. Focus groups, for example, what do they consider a focus group?
It would be similar to our last thing where, for example, we would set up one of business leaders and we would go to the Chamber of Commerce and we would invite people to come in and talk about the library for an hour. And that's the focus group.
What about the ethnic pockets and Niles that we claim we want to talk?
I think that is going to be the hardest thing, and I did talk with them about that, and they agreed that that was going to be the hardest thing because you can get some things translated and you can send some people out that speak the languages, but basically it's hard to get enough of those people because he's saying, let's say you get 20 Gujarati answers back, that's not statistically significant. So he wants to it to be enough people in any of the groups that you're looking at that it is statistically significant.
I agree. But there are places in Niles where you can get a large group of people people who are Muslims.
Well, that's where we would be going.
So you get more than 20 people, or you could go to areas where it's maybe an Indian population.
Sure.
They congregate for purposes.
Well, I think that's
the
idea.
Where we would
think
go.
That's the idea. Go ahead, Karen.
Oh, so you're just wondering among our volunteers, do we have volunteers who speak other languages who might reach out to those?
We do have a few, yes. They're mostly women, senior women, but we do have a few. Depends on the time of that they could go, because some are still working, you know, so it depends on the availability, but if it's weekends, you know, we do have some people that speak other languages.
Patty, do you have a question?
I was just going to say, it sounds to me like this is not going to be an easy thing to decide on, and we do have the budget we need to get into. So can we table this for another meeting?
I think that's a great idea. Is it possible to have one or the other, something come, another group come in and give us their
sure.
thoughts in the next meeting?
Sure, they'd be happy
maybe
to.
Maybe we can compare.
Yeah,
apples,
or whatever
works for
you.
Thank you. I think I feel just a little more comfortable talking with another group. And maybe these prices are really what you have to pay to get this kind of information. And that may well be the case. I guess I would just feel more comfortable talking with another group if I could do that. I am really starting to hear that we have some volunteers. That was one concern that I don't really know who's doing this work. As it's listening to them. To me, if we could in the meantime just sort of, you know, gauge how many potential volunteer hours we would have, I'd hate to wade into this project and realize that we just don't have the power to collect this information and not really be able to finish the survey well because we just don't have the people to go out and do that work. So I know you can't compel these people to work for us a certain number of hours, but you could sort of gauge when and how many hours these people are willing to put in. That would be helpful.
Sure. I was wondering, do they have to be a certain age? Like, do they have to be 18 in order to be, you know, what you think? I'm just wondering, because, I mean, I know we have, I'm just coming from high school, we have a lot of NHS students who need volunteer hours, service hours, and especially at my niece, since that's in our district, and they have all different, like, we have 50 countries at my niece, you know, and they're always looking at all different types of, you know, where they have to put in, you know, 5 service hours. I can't remember how many service hours NHS has. You talk to the government teachers or the NHS representative, and I mean, I don't know if that's a possibility of a reach out and build, you know, some kids making, you know, a difference. It could be something too, because they have to have those hours.
They,
you know, they can work in teams.
They
have, you know, that
absolutely
work,
definitely.
Right. That they work in teams. I mean, that would definitely,
yeah.
Nobody goes to individual.
I don't believe that East has a key club, but I think they have what it would be equivalent, similar would be, I think, a Rotary Club, which also does volunteer stuff.
Right.
And like you say, with the number of students there that speak other languages,
it
might be the best place to go, too.
It's so many. And, I mean, because
so we do have teen volunteers, too.
Right,
Here, from the schools.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
right.
Again, it depends on the timing of the survey.
Exactly.
The
right. Because we get out in May. However, you know, the head of the clubs, there's always the assistant principal, he's in charge of the clubs, he would know too. He could give you an email to shoot it out to all the club sponsors, which then they would know what their clubs can do. It's within one email. It's emails that are already created.
I am that sponsor for West. That's why I know, but I don't think West is part of our district.
Yeah, just an idea.
But East, I know, has similar clubs.
I just wanted to add one more thing and then I'll let you. Just for me, I really think that community assessment is really a key component. It's a non-negotiable. I mean, I really want to go and make sure that they get out in the community and assess. I think that's really important. I think we do need someone to help us, guide us through the strategic plan. I think if we don't have someone to help us, I think that's really going to be a faltering. I think this is a very important step for the library to have a strategic plan and with a professional input. I'm just kind of looking over and just to help develop the overall strategic plan in itself. But
Another suggestion, I was thinking that, you know, I'm sure the people in the, well, people who live in Niles and people who work in the library, we should consider schools, which I know you already are involved with, but there are other groups that maybe we can talk to either the president of organizations or a chair who could distribute some of your questionnaires or surveys. And then you can get certain groups, and you can target certain ethnicities or certain areas. You don't have to worry about who's coming to the laundromat, but you can then target all these different groups. We need to give it some thought. If you're gonna go over her 1,000 or her 500. So we need to figure out, are we gonna stop after, you know, you have volunteers at these certain places? Are we gonna realize Niles consists of all of these areas, these components of these areas or this and that? Are we gonna reach out to them? Because otherwise we're still not gonna be adequately serving them. And if we can get someone from an organization or a school in those areas that have that populace, we can give them the service.
And, but we don't just wanna focus on the North End, we gotta focus on the whole.
So I'm sure, I'm just saying, but 1,500 now we're talking. In the whole Niles Library District, that's really tight. What are we gonna learn?
Well, I guess we'll see when we compare to someone else and see what they want to do. Maybe the 500 is gonna sound like, wow, that's a lot.
But
I mean, I'm just saying, I don't know, we'll see.
And you know what, just because someone's gonna do less, is 500 enough for us? I mean, we need to, we're gonna spend 30-some thousand dollars for what? That's how you need to look at it.
We can also.
We're going the wrong way, I don't know.
We, depending on who we go, we can talk to them by increasing.
Yeah, I mean, if we're gonna, if somebody else explains.
I know, but you know what, I kinda don't wanna say, hey, want a thousand, I wanna raise it, I want someone who can come to me with these ideas.
All right, so, we'll, take a roll to table this until we hear one more.
Two more.
I think, if you have considered two other ones, I don't see that's a problem with this. You know, we're not under a strict deadline.
Right.
Right.
Well.
I mean, we wanna get it done.
We wanna kinda get moving, right, before it gets to, right.
Of course, but.
Well, once you get into summer.
We don't wanna choose somebody just because we wanna get moving, we wanna choose the right one.
That's true.
That'd be uncomfortable that we.
I just wanted to get things rolling because we heard so loudly from the community when we were doing the levy process, you don't have a plan. And I don't wanna hear that again when we're doing the levy this year.
Well, we need to have a good one, we don't want just any kind, because we'll hear it again.
I agree with you, but I think these people will do a good one.
Our motion?
Okay, Pammy?
Second.
And. Okay. Please take a few, take a roll?
Yeah.
Okay. Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Okay, the next item on our agenda is the discussion of the 2016-17 tentative budget ordinance 16-01. We will have a chance to go through the budget, ask questions, make any changes, and then I will call for a motion to approve the tentative ordinance. We will need to approve the tentative ordinance tonight to keep to our schedule to have an approved budget at the start of the fiscal year. So Greg has a short presentation to start us off. Greg.
Yeah, first thing I'm doing is I'm passing around.
Thank you.
Substitute pages for
revisions.
We found some calculation errors
I'm wondering if
so take B1 out of the book and replace it with what we just passed around.
So this one's revised. We should mark them so we don't get confused.
Second thing we're passing around is just a three-page presentation, and it's entitled Tax Levy Budgets and Appropriations and How They Fit Together. Every time we talk about any one of these three things, questions arise on what we're trying to accomplish here and what year we're looking at taxes for and what year they apply to in the budget years and so forth. So we start with the tax levy. If you look at the first page behind the title page.
It helps if I pay attention to where I'm sticking. Okay, thank you.
the key here is that, you know, Cook County levies real estate taxes 1 year in arrears. So in any given year, we're paying the taxes that apply to the previous year. Mm-hmm. In 2015, we're collecting 2014's tax levy, and this year, 2016, we're collecting the 2015 levy. If you look at the next page, we look at the budget and appropriation ordinance. Our fiscal year, if you remember, runs July 1st through June 30th. That's the line at the bottom of the page showing the fiscal, the budget and appropriation. It is, but I'm doing it this way. I hear it.
The projector's not on, I'm taking a while.
So the budget is basically the contract between the administrative team and the board as to what the spending limits are. The appropriation is the actual legal limit of what the library district can spend the given year, and if need be, it can be changed, but it has to be changed as if it was a new appropriation down the road. I drew the arrows for the appropriation much larger than the budget. The reason I did that is, generally speaking, it's the practice here to multiply the budget by two, and that's to account for possible windfalls that we may receive during the course of the year, and give us room to spend it in the line items as so the board sees fit. In that case, they would increase the budget but leave the appropriation at the state level. If you look at the third page, this is how it fits all together. So if you look at calendar year 2015, for example, and the calendar year line is the line across the top of the graphic, you can see in 2015, we're collecting the 2014 tax levy. But the 2014 tax levy is half collected in fiscal 14-15 and half collected in fiscal 15-16. In each one of those two fiscal years, we have different budgets and different appropriations as they apply to the fiscal year. We've talked about this from time to time, but you know, if you have any questions that to clarify anything in your mind, that you have to take them out.
I think that the graph helps to see how these different, three different things fit together.
So do we know what our 2016-17 appropriations?
We distributed the appropriation and the tentative appropriation and budget ordinance with the board materials. If you turn to page 19, that's where the document begins. The totals, the grand total, is on page 21.
Bringing the budget materials on
tonight's board.
Tonight's board.
Okay.
Well, so how much is there? I just wanted to figure out the sheet.
The budget is the total, grand total budget for all line items is $6,385,960.
And the appropriations is double that?
Approximately double that, $12,771,921.
What do we anticipate with the state being in this situation? What do you think we'll really get?
From
revenues. I see Park Ridge is stressing and concerned about it. I mean, are we thinking they'll cut it a certain percent? Does anyone have any idea?
Well, we've got 95% of our revenue from local real estate taxes, which have nothing to do with the state.
95%
is all.
Do you have that on a certain page?
I did. I had that in the budget book. It's on page C.
Oh, I think you're gonna.
On page C1.
So I have a question. Why isn't our
page
two on the pie chart about the state?
I don't.
So we don't need to be concerned about the state revenues being cut?
The only money that we get from the state is the per capita grant. The per capita grant last year, that's all we get from the state. Okay, the per capita grant last year was $71,605.
We just got a.
And we just got the letter.
Right.
At the last board meeting, and that was $44,157, which is what I used for in all the budget documents.
Park Ridge, though, is a municipal library. They are part of the village of, or the city of Park Ridge, so their money does not just strictly come from property taxes. We're a district and that's different.
But it's still, state revenues are their concern, and I was wondering why.
Well, like, the village gets a lot of sales tax, which is collected by the state. I don't know, but maybe that's why they're concerned.
Okay, they get three major sources from the state. They get sales tax, which is obviously their biggest. Villages also get something called personal property replacement tax. We get that too, but it's about $140,000 each year. Theirs is much larger. And the third thing that we get, or they get, is a portion of state income tax. So the 3.5%, which would be 5%, that we all pay. A portion goes to the village in which you live.
Okay, so then our revenues are generated from our taxpayers.
That's correct.
Okay.
So if you look at page C1, if you look at the pie chart there, you can see that 95% comes from property taxes, 2% comes from replacement taxes, the per capita grants about 1%, investment income counts for about 1%, fines account for about 1%, and then we have some other revenue in there which is below 1%, 0.something. On the following page, on page C2, you can see the breakout for the budget that we're talking about for the 2015-2016 estimate, as well as the six previous fiscal years. So going back to 2009-2010, our total revenue was $8 million. This budget year, we're planning on 7.1 million.
So do we want to chunk this? Like, do we want to go to, we'll start with the first page of the budget. And if we have any questions, let's just do it per section. If you have any questions or concerns, and then we'll go to the next section, go to the next section, and try to get through this budget.
So that would be starting on page B3 of your binder.
B3?
B3.
Okay.
So that's where the numbers are. C7 is where the explanation is.
Oh, see. Do we have any details on how you came up with these figures? I read your explanations. There are more generalities than any specifics. I mean, I thought we were going to have a board meeting to discuss the budget so I could learn what we spent this money on this year, determine whether or not it was advantageous and what your plans were based on what your department had submitted to you. None of that's included in this. Just looking down line items. This isn't reviewing the budget. There's no previous year. There's no goals for the new year. There's no analysis. We're right back where we were a year ago.
I think there was a lot of analysis actually in her descriptions.
But that's my point. They're descriptions. She told us about it. She has
but we're not here to micromanage. We're here to
review the budget. Right. We're not able to review this budget because we're not given any.
Okay, all right. That's your opinion, because that's not true in my opinion. So we can go around and, yes.
I just have one more thing to say. In your opinion, I know that's not true. Mm-hmm. The village does not review their budget like this. They have last year's budget, what they've spent, and what their plans are for the new year, for the new budget. Every department has to submit their request. They're evaluated. There's goals. School districts do the same thing. They start in January. Everyone has to analyze their spending. We don't do that. I know it's the way you want to do it, but no one reviews the budget like this.
Not necessarily the way that I want to do it. We talk to, we go line by line, that's what we're doing, that is what we talk about.
You're reading a number on a piece of paper, that's not.
And we're, and also they've also said what they were spending money on, and they've looked at numbers.
I read it, there's nothing factual in there. It's all like story post, that's all it is.
I guess I just don't understand the criticism. If I start on page D3 and move forward, I see numbers for every single expenditure, every single salary, what we spent, what we actually spent, beginning with 209.10, 10.11, 11.12, 12.13, so forth, 15, what the projected actual was for 15.16, what the annual budget was for 15.16, and what the proposed budget is. I see numbers for every single expenditure, you know, down to software licenses, internet charges.
But what you're talking about are categories, columns.
Well, yeah, they're categories.
What constitutes those amounts?
How much detail you want? Janitorial supplies. I mean, do you want to know exactly
how
much money we spent?
I want to know how much money we spent on all the programs that this library has had in the past year that all these different departments have created that involve people from Niles, people maybe not from Niles, whether it was food, entertainment. What did it cost to do this particular program? And how many people came? Was it cost effective? Are we changing it next year? What are we doing? That's how you validate spending. We're not analyzing anything. We're just looking at a bunch of numbers under different columns.
Actually,
I'm aware of that.
Actually, that's in every single month that we come to a board meeting.
No,
all
it's
those
not.
All of those numbers are actually there. With how many people that come to the program, how much, yeah, it actually.
Okay, on this piece of paper, it says 25 people attended this program. On another piece of paper, it says we paid $780 for this program. What did the $780 constitute? That's how you evaluate programs, and it's usually done
and
automatically.
That would be each department's job, and that's what we hire them for. That's micromanaging. That is
not
their
micromanaging.
Job.
When
that is their job.
Okay, it's not micromanaging. For the past year, we have not been able to get answers.
You're able to look
questions.
At any of the backup every single month.
Backup is just a check. It's not a summary.
All right, go ahead.
Can I ask a question, Carolyn? So here, like your article.
What does it say about our programs? 101 people?
Right, okay, so like
what
the
does
rise,
that mean?
I understand. So the Rise and Shine story time for this particular month, which was from our last board meeting, they had 101 patrons showing
mm-hmm.
for that.
Is there a cost associated with that?
So that's what you're asking for, if you want to know how much cost. So the only problem, and I understand what you're asking for,
mm-hmm.
but the only problem is then you have to, they have to come up with an actual cost for each one of these all the way down the line.
No, that's not true, because this isn't necessarily what you need to do to report on an event. If you have an event, you have to plan it. When you plan it, you figure out what you're doing. Well, you have to spend money for planning the event. What did it cost? And that's how you evaluate.
They work within that budget for the year, and they're meeting all different needs of all the different subgroups for their demographic, for their
We work within a budget. Right. Not a budget that we review to determine
which they
if we're
review.
Wasting.
Yes,
no,
they have been reviewing.
No. We've been wasting money left and right.
Okay.
We don't do anything about it.
Okay, so what questions or concerns do you have on this? On this
that
on
there
this
isn't
page?
Adequate information
okay.
to explain any of these line items.
Okay.
You can't possibly pass a budget without any details.
Okay.
And I think the question is, some of you probably don't do this for a living, so you don't need to have this background.
Okay, so, Karen, do you have any questions on the items?
No, I looked over ahead of time. I called Greg with some questions and concerns that I have, and got the answers that I needed. So, at this point, I don't have any other questions.
Are we just doing the one page, or are we doing, you're talking about the whole thing?
I'm actually talking about the whole thing.
Okay. All right. Gabby?
My concern, excuse me, that I saw was it shows for this year we have budgeted $69,000 for consultants. Why is there that much budgeted for consultants? Are we really planning on spending that?
I think for the proposed is $75,000.
Oh, $75,000, excuse me, $75,000.
So This year, last year, when we went through the process, we put in an amount, I think it was $50,000, as a placeholder to hire a strategic consultant. Obviously, we haven't done that for the current fiscal year. So we repeated the amount for next year, so $50,000 is a placeholder for a strategic consultant. The balance of it is IT projects that we're, that we're planning to move some of our assets to the cloud so that we can have a smaller footprint here in the building.
So there's a consultant fee to move? Why is it a consultant if you're doing it? Are you hiring a consultant to tell you about doing that?
We're hiring a consultant.
Switch around some possible, because that was actually one of my questions.
Yeah, because that to me seemed like an awful lot for consultant fees. I was just curious where those consultants
If you look back to the year previous, we spent over $100,000 on consultants.
That has nothing to do with next year.
Okay, so, all right, so if I'm gathering what you're saying, so we have a $50,000 placeholder for the consultant for strategic plan.
For 15-16?
For 15-16, right. So that money wasn't spent, obviously, so that's going to go back into the...
It will not be spent.
Right, but that's the next placeholder for the next...
That's right.
Well, we already know that that's not even where we're going to go, since it's like 39, right?
Well, it's 34.5.
Right, so we know, so maybe we can even bump it down like 10 or 15? We could probably... So that could be someplace now.
Yeah, because the 34 is the top one that we're talking, so if we bump it down...
It's 75 total.
Yeah, so maybe that line item we can at least go down a little.
If you take $15,000 out.
Makes a lot, but I think at least it's...
Specifically, $34,000 is for strategic planning. How much do you need?
$25,000.
$25,000 for a technology consultant?
Yeah, it's actually a consultant on a couple of different projects.
What would those projects be? We just talked about the cloud. I know that was something you talked about before.
Well, there's several components that we'd like to move to the cloud. So if you move our Exchange server, which takes care of all of our mail, it's the basically Outlook backend. That's one crisis. We move other assets to the cloud. That'll be another one. I don't have a breakdown.
I mean, would you think that it's just best to maybe just put it down 10, just to be, keep it a little cushioned, or, but at least keep it...
Bring it down a little
bit. I think that one we can bring down a little bit.
I have another question about the technology consultants. What did we determine is going to be the cost once you move everything to the cloud?
Well, that would be a future discussion.
Well, that came up in the past, and I was wondering if it's gotten more expensive or... where we are with that, because that was an issue.
Well, essentially what you're doing is you're paying a subscription fee per user to access the assets in the cloud, and the benefit is that you no longer have to replace equipment because you're actually buying a service, not equipment that somebody else is providing. Mm-hmm. You don't have to maintain that equipment. You don't have to apply patches and upgrades. Really all you have to do is pay for communications.
So what would the cost be for us?
I don't have that in front of me.
Last time we talked, it was $100,000.
I don't believe I gave you that.
Yeah, we were told when some of the employees opted to take some retirement or pension, we were going to save $100,000, and then when we asked what the cost of this would be, it was $100,000, so we weren't really saving. And I'm concerned that we need to know the cost before. You want to approve this budget,
but that
tonight,
would still be a board. But that would still be a board decision in the future. And in our, it's not $100,000 here. That's not.
What I'm saying is, where is that cost, which is going to be after this $25,000 consultant fee? Then comes the cost for whatever we determine. Is that in the budget as well?
Yeah, they're in the software fees.
How much did you put in there for that?
I think it was $15,000 or something like that. I don't have that list in front of me.
But that's my point. We don't have information tonight, and you're going to decide on this budget.
Okay, can we move on? Thank you. Well, we're going to discuss it line by line. That's fine. We'll discuss it.
He just said he doesn't have the information. So it doesn't matter what line you're on?
As long as it's within what we are, what we're planning, we cannot go over it. So if you're worried about $100,000, if it's $15,000, we're obviously not going to spend $100,000.
Well, he's not even.
So, but the thing is, it's not going to be the hundred. So if you're concerned about a hundred, it's not going to be.
We don't know yet.
Okay.
My other question was pertaining to trustees' expense. Where does that figure come from?
Well, last year we had an annual budget of $10,000, which was consistent with the previous years. When I say last year, I mean 15-16. We've spent less than $1,000 on that line item. So I felt that a reduction to $4,000 was reasonable.
Yes, yeah.
And if need be, we could reduce it further.
Okay, because I personally like, was curious why it was up to 10 to begin with.
The board used to pay for the staff and board Christmas party, and they stopped paying for that.
So that's why.
So the cost of that.
Oh, yeah, previous year, we'll look at the previous years.
I was curious why it was.
That was the main expense. And then it varies, you know, how many trustees choose to go to different conferences and things like that.
Okay.
So are we saying we do not have any trustees' expenses for the end of this fiscal year?
No, we have $883.
And that's all we plan on spending until next budget?
That's not the plan. The plan is that I think we have two trustees are going to Orlando for the ALA annual conference, and that money will come up there.
So then.
And that's at the very end of June, so that won't be showing up until July.
So assuming that's happening and anticipating costs, then where does that leave us in our budget? Because then we won't have not spent so much money. I mean, we won't have such a large amount. What do we plan on spending this year for trustees?
Well, it's supposed to be here then, can I ask?
Or the 10th. I mean, it's up to the trustees how much of their line they want to spend. That's up to you. If you don't spend it, then it will still be there and it will roll.
Well, I mean, you don't just go spend money. I mean, you assume here for a hotel, I'm just asking.
Oh, you're asking about their cost? I don't know. I imagine they're similar to what you're supposed to do in Francisco.
So how much is that?
What was yours?
I have no idea. I was one of many. I don't know. I asked for that backup, never got it. So I can't answer that question.
Well, it depends on what your airfare is for those days, and it depends on what the hotel rates are at that time, and.
So then we plan on spending.
And you get so much budget per day.
My question is, then we plan on spending this budget line down. Okay, it won't be.
You're talking about this year's trustee line?
Which is $10,000.
It was budgeted at $10,000. Obviously, that was too much because you guys didn't go to a lot of conferences and you didn't spend it on anything else.
Okay, so we don't know how much we'll spend by the end of the year. Okay, thank you, I got it.
I don't think that's what she said. We do know roughly what we're going to spend by the end of the year. After a couple of trustees go to a conference, I don't know who's going.
We don't know the amount.
But it might be in the next budget though, correct? It might not.
No, this conference will be in the current year's budget, and then the next year it is, ALA is in Chicago, and I imagine a lot of you are going to.
Well, if it's in Chicago, that would make sense because we wouldn't have transportation and all that.
Right, it would be low because of $4,000.
We wouldn't have to pay for hotels or anything.
Yeah, and it's not a PLA year. So you always have up and down whether it's a PLA year or not.
Yeah, and if it's Chicago, yeah, the expense itself should be a lot less.
Right, and none of you went to PLA this year, so I actually did expect some of you to go, and that's why there was more money in that one.
Okay.
Actually, I just got the other line.
I actually wanted to go, but due to personal reasons could not go, but I appreciated the opportunity to possibly go.
All right, so that's the trustee.
Well, we're on this page. Can I ask a question on professional development?
Sure.
So previously it was as low as 28, not 16, 28, 23, 16, 18. Last year it was 40 grand. Now we're back down to 28. First of all, what's kind of like in professional development? And then second of all, why are we decreasing it from last year's?
It's PLA again. This past year was a PLA year.
Okay.
Next year is not a PLA year.
Gotcha. All right.
So that's a big part of the difference.
So that's whether or not they go to those conventions or whatever.
Yes, the Public Library Association convention. And then the other things that go in that line are any kind of professional development. There used to be a great deal offered through NSLS when it was our regional library system, and now those meetings are being offered by a number of different places in a lot of there's the Laconi ones, there are Rails ones, there are a lot of different professional development ones. People do a lot of webinars, those come out of this. Any kind of professional training is coming out of that line.
So what's the amount for next year again? It's already earmarked, correct?
For next year, we have $28,415 budgeted.
Okay, so you already know who's going where.
I have a list of who has, wants to go to which conference, yes.
Then the mileage, it's tiny amount, but I'm just surprised you're not going to down $2,500 when you spent $3,800. We spent $3,800 last year.
I'm not sure what that's about.
Where does that at?
Couple, just
right
like
below.
After professional development.
Right below it.
It's based on the requests of the individual departments.
Can I say last budget year, I went to Springfield for the island,
right,
and I drove down three times. This year, I'm not doing that in each of
oh,
the drives.
Oh, well, really? That wouldn't come out of professional development?
The mileage might would.
Really?
Mileage
oh,
is always.
Okay. I thought mileage maybe was just for the van, the drive around.
No.
Okay.
That would be
okay.
Nothing.
Makes
sense.
And then I just had another one with the telephone. It just looked as though.
I'm sorry, what page are you on?
Same one. It's kind
oh,
of.
No, yeah,
because it looked as though our annual budget this year was 16.5 and the proposed is 13. I know it's not a lot different, is it? But the actual is 12, so is that why we went to 13?
Yeah, we looked
at
it.
Are we going to go out like on a payment plan or something? Is that why, how we know that it's going to be 13 now, kind of all the way across the board?
There's two or three components. You know, there's AT&T, we also pay call one. And when you add those components up and annualize them, it's about $13,000.
Okay, so that's kind of
so that's pretty close to what it will be then.
Yeah, just like before, it was just a lot more money budgeted. So I guess I'm glad that we're kind of trying to level it off and make it correct. What was the only questions I had on that page? Any other questions on that page? Okay, so I think the only change then we're asking for is we was like 10,000 on the
consultant.
Was that okay? I think
yeah.
That, okay.
Yeah.
Do we have bids yet on or any proposals from whom we plan on consulting with? So we're just making these numbers up.
It's an estimate based on.
You don't need to provide any backup before you come up with a number. We just.
It's always an estimate, and we don't have to spend it, just like we didn't this year.
I know, but the point is, you should probably spend a little more time thinking about who you're going to.
I'm sure that they have to spend time.
But we have no proposals.
I'm really glad that they're building the money in there so that if we choose to spend it, and we may choose not to spend it,
exactly.
The money is there. We may decide not to spend it at all. We might decide to spend less. It's just like when you're making your family budget. You want to make sure you have a little extra money in there to make sure you have enough money to cover what you might need to buy. You don't necessarily commit yourself to buying something. You just want to make sure the money's there.
You ever entertain the idea of maybe cutting 10%?
Yeah, and that kind of.
We just cut debt. Now, if you look down the line here, there's a lot of things
that
are cut.
Did we do that? Is that what you did, Grant? Did you come up with the 10%? Is that why they're decreasing?
And there was a 10% cut in the past, and then people complained that they could not buy the programs and supplies.
10%.
And yes, 10%.
Yes.
Yes.
We have to justify
yes.
That.
And
okay,
Carolyn,
Carolyn,
if you
we're
keep
gonna go through next page,
it every
please.
Year,
we're
if people
go through
already
page.
Are complaining that they're not getting the supplies they need or the materials
okay.
That they
can
want.
Can I tell
to
you something? Until you evaluate documentation, until you see where somebody is suffering, you can't believe that's really happening. And since we don't take on that responsibility, it's correct.
Okay, there was a page before, and I think we didn't go through that. If anybody had questions or concerns with the program and the library supplies.
What page are you on?
Are you going to
B before the page
four?
Prior.
Not two or three?
Yeah, not the salaries.
Okay,
four. But the general fund expenditures for the, let's see, where
library
it starts with the
operating.
CCS charges, the processing and supplies. here. That one was very clear. There's so many negatives that the budgets did go down because they did evaluate and they did look through just as what was said in prior.
So we eliminated some of those?
There's a lot that they actually made the budget go down, which I was actually very impressed.
I mean, if you look, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
If you look at page B3, B4, B5, and you run your eye down the far right column, you'll see that it's negatives going, the budget's going down in many of the categories.
Many of them.
Many of the categories. It's being reduced amount that is budgeted. Processing supplies down 20%. Library supplies down 36%. Programming and support for adult down 20%. Programming and supplies event down 47%.
So I have one question.
38%.
Excuse
me, I'm not done yet. Per capita grant expenditures down 38%. Professional development down 27%. Telephone down 21%. Trustee expenses down 60%. A lot of these expenses are going down.
So my question is, we're showing they're going down. Will we hold to these figures, or since we...
How often do we overspend?
I don't know.
You do know. You're a trustee.
Yeah.
You get that every single
I see a lot of the
things.
Finances.
I see
for
a lot.
For the 2 years you were a treasurer, and you know that a lot of... I mean, all the time.
We've overspent quite a bit.
Except in consultant and lawyer fees last year because of the votes. It's very true.
Well, actually, Carol,
look at the numbers.
Carol,
that's true.
Actually,
very
if
true.
You look at the actuals for the other years, but we don't have the budget.
We raised the levy $800,000. If we're not overspending, why did we need it? If we're cutting substantially, why did we raise the levy $800,000? We can't.
Because we were going to go into a negative if we kept the levy.
If you keep increasing at 2%, well, if he's decreasing it at 2%, why do we raise the levy?
Okay.
I don't think.
So I know trustee's figures.
All right. Okay. Thank you. Any questions or concerns on page B4?
Yes, I had sent an email or two asking for programming information. Because I've heard from so many people in Niles about how we waste money. And I thought it was a very common tool for everyone who creates an event to evaluate it and decide if we're wasting money or not. And I even mentioned it here, and I never got any response from it.
Okay, actually, that was, I think, right in one of their pieces here. That every time there is program budget was raised last year and so not increased this year, and although the candy exhibit is ready to be very successful, it was something where it was every time a program was, they reevaluate, they tweak it, they audit it,
mm-hmm.
check, and that's what they do every single time there's programming. It was in our notes here.
Yeah.
Okay, and then let me just throw
so programs with a low attendance are tweaked or discarded altogether. We
and
do encourage experimentation, and some experiments are not successful. That's...
Okay, those are great generalities, but let me throw this out there. Whether you're overspending or you think you're not, we are aware of the fact that most of the people that come to the Niles Library to participate in all these costly programs aren't even Niles taxpayers.
Okay.
And if I can't get you to decide to give me a breakdown so I can confidently think we're decreasing costs, what can you do about not providing all of this entertainment or all of this programming to non-Niles residents?
Well,
you have to start considering
library.
That.
We're public library.
No, you're funded by Niles taxpayers.
Well,
why
it's
are
a district.
We,
it's not just Niles. We're a district.
Well, people from Northbrook aren't in our district. People from Chicago are not. People from Park Ridge are not.
Right.
So sure. What can we do to address that in terms of how much money
I
we
believe
spend?
There's a process for each time that we have
what's
a
the process?
Okay, so in the first place, you, as you're saying that you thought that we should give you all of our analysis on each one of the programs that have been given, the amount of staff time that went into it, the costs associated with it. So for example, if somebody bought craft supplies for a program, you want to know what the cost was of the craft supplies that went into that program. And the fact is that we, program by program, do analyze each one of them As I said in the notes, we decide whether it was a success or a failure, we tweak or we discard. We do not keep a running record of every single program in writing.
Okay.
It's all done in a fluid basis because we have hundreds of programs here.
I'm sure you do.
So that is the first thing. The second thing is, so it's not that we aren't doing the analysis, it's that we're not keeping a written record of it and handing it to the board, because that level of detail is not appropriate for a board. You are supposed to be looking at a much higher level. The second thing is that, well, I lost my train of thought. What was your second? Oh, about the people that are non-residents coming to programs. So with all of our programs that we think have a possibility of filling up, we register Niles cardholders first. Every program like that, the Niles cardholders have 5 days to register where nobody else is allowed to register, and then we give the remaining seats away to other people that would want to come, because there's absolutely no point in having empty seats in a program.
And maybe you shouldn't have that program.
Then when we look at that program and we say, oh my gosh, you know, we only had 2 Niles cardholders, but we had 3 other cardholders, then we look at that and we go, well, this is maybe not the program for our community. We do that kind of analysis.
Okay, well, when I asked you before if we could start figuring out who comes to these programs, you said there isn't some kind of checker at the door. So I don't know how you determine who comes to these programs and who doesn't, but we need to figure it out. Because I don't care how much you're saving, if we're supporting Northbrook and Chicago, we're wasting our money.
Well, you do understand that our people are going to Northbrook, and they're going to Displays, and they're going to Park Ridge. It's all a sharing thing. It's like the Money Smart Week brochure that I brought in last week. They had the long list of all of the Money Smart programs at all of the libraries. Our people are going to those at other libraries. Other people are coming to the ones at our library. That's how libraries work.
Okay.
We share
resources.
But
in this library, the percentage of Niles residents is so much smaller. The majority of the people that come to these programs, a couple of times I've been here, are Park Ridge residents. We don't charge a fee to anyone to come here. Park Ridge charges me a fee if I want to attend some of their things and I'm not a Park Ridge cardholder. Why don't we initiate some of that? I mean, we're not here to support the world.
Okay, this, we'll talk about that at another time.
But it's part of programming.
But, and I understand that. Mm-hmm. I totally do. But seriously, can we, this sounds like a subject that's going to take more discussion.
Not at all. It's
and I'm
program.
Not saying I'm against it, because I'm not. But maybe we need to talk about that at another meeting so we can get back into the budget.
But we said that a year ago, and here we are with a budget, spending money and supporting, like, 1/4 of the people who come to this library are Niles taxpayers. Not a good idea.
Remember, where you're getting that number
first
from.
Of all, they didn't think of what I don't know.
Because certain events, certain days that I was here, this was the tally.
Where are you getting a tally from? Are you walking up to people and asking to see their
not
library
really.
Card?
I know the truth. I came here one night to, I think I needed to scan some items. And I had a park like way down the block. I'm like, wow, I wonder what's going on. Come in the library, nothing was really happening. So as I walked through the lot, I was looking at how many people had Village and Isle stickers. 20 cars had Village and Isle stickers. 86 had Park Ridge and other places.
The unincorporated half of the district, though,
but
have stickers.
Half of our residents don't live in the Village of Niles. Half of the district residents.
But again, are they really our residents, or are they from Chicago? People
honestly,
who come to your events that I don't go to tell me everyone here at these events is from Chicago. I'm just asking you to do something about it. Whether you want to talk about it tonight or not. But we've brought this up several times, and you know what's going to happen? The meeting will end, it'll be 5-1, and you won't do anything about it. I'm just saying it's something you should consider.
Okay. Thank you. So any more on the, any other questions or concerns on this page?
I'm sorry, I forgot what page we were on.
We're still on the B4.
I'm sorry.
I mean, most of them are going down, most of them are negative.
Oh, probably. Oh yeah, you know, and since we're on this page, we do have to, Carolyn, to your point, we spend about $80,000 on programming, that's the budget, and that's really only about 1%.
It doesn't matter. If it's $80,000 that could be used to benefit Niles, that's what we should be doing with it.
Well, okay, but we are elected here, yeah, and then my personal feeling is that our programming budget is appropriate for the level of size that we have of this library and the number of people that we do service, my opinion on the programming.
Oh, and then just my other question, I don't know if I got an answer. So we're showing that we're decreasing each line item, are we holding ourselves to this budget amount then, we're not gonna go over, is that like, are we gonna work?
I didn't say we were decreasing every line item.
Well, for everything that we're decreasing, I mean, so we have a budget in place, are we going over?
As Susan said, our practice is that we hold to our budget.
Well, we bought a car for $10,000, that wasn't even in last year, this year's budget, so you can't say that.
But that was a single time thing.
We have, our practice and our programming, yes, we have.
I don't know about that, again, I'm just saying, we seem to come up with reasons to spend and go over, I'm just saying we're gonna hold on to.
You know, I just really feel like we don't get credit for the things that we do, and in fact, if you will find, if you were to look at the list from last year, you would find that we did not overspend on things. We don't overspend on things. In Greg's presentation, he said that the budget is a contract between the staff of the library and the board. You set the limits, we keep to the limits. You are implying on the camera in front of taxpayers that we routinely overspend, and we don't. My staff does an outstanding job of getting good deals on things, seeking out excellent vendors, trying to save money, and when we do save money, we get yelled at for that too. So I don't appreciate the fact that we do not get.
For seeming leery, but we raised the levy $800,000. If we're watching our spending, why did we raise it?
That is a separate issue.
It's monetary.
You're talking about us overspending our budget, and I am here to tell you, we do not overspend our budget.
Then why did we have to increase $800,000 if we're okay with the budget?
Can we just stick with the budget right now? We're talking about the budget, that's a whole separate.
I was gonna say, just because we say that much, doesn't mean we're gonna spend that much. That was, this was the only time we could raise the taxes. And that had been discussed back before we discussed this.
But we shouldn't raise the taxes if we don't have to raise it.
It was done.
I know, and it's trash.
It's done, let's move on with this, please.
Sure.
All right, so, okay, so we're good with this page.
We're on B4.
Right, so we're done with that B4. We're done with B5, and we're done with B6.
Oh, did we go through B6?
Yeah, we went.
Oh, no, 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 B6 we didn't, I'm sorry.
Not really.
Yes, with the deferred compensation and group health and.
Yeah, because that's something I marked on there that I wanted to discuss a little bit.
Group health?
Group health, we have, you know, as far as I understand it, we're doing, that's raised because we have no choice because of the government regulations. Because now we have to make sure, group health, isn't that because now the government says that the insurance has to be for more people and so on, so it has to go up.
The Affordable Care Act rules are phasing in on us, so starting with our July 1st renewal, anybody in the last 12 months who has worked an average of 30 hours per week or more, we're obligated to offer insurance to them.
Mm-hmm.
So remember our full-time designation is 37 and a half hours.
Mm-hmm.
There's 45 people who are already getting 37 and a half hours. So we have 45 full-time people, and to that we're adding 8 people. Okay, the mystery here is I don't know if they're going to take single, family, or refuse it,
mm-hmm.
or, you know, just cover kids, you know, or mm-hmm. just cover their spouse, or whatever the case is. Those are very different, pricing numbers. I've also added into this number medical inflation, which is running at about 9%. What I've seen most recently is 6.5. But on a 3% differential at this level, it's $12,000 or $13,000. So I mean, that's not where the big money is. The big mm-hmm. money is actually with the growth in our group that we have, where we have to offer that according to the Affordable Care Act.
Okay. And the other one that I was questioning was the deferred compensation. That is technically what we are considering our retirement?
Yeah, so the deferred compensation number is a calculated number based on full-time salaries at 7.5%. And so the $183,000, $182,931, actually represents a perpetuation of the current plan. Now, the board is talking about modifying the retirement benefits. We had presentations from IMRF as well as from the current provider, ICMA. The board has to make a decision. There is another vehicle out there called 401A, but we haven't seen a proposal on that yet.
Okay. My question is, with what we did see from IMRF, not that I'm saying we are voting for it, because believe me, I'm still open. Do you remember how much they said it would cost us for the first year?
Yeah, first year cost would be at 8.12% over a salary base of $2,733,000. Mm-hmm. Would be $221,000.
So technically, if we did decide to go with that, this will not cover it?
This will not cover it, that's correct.
Okay,
now,
thank you.
I also want to point out that we do have life, long-term disability, accidental death and disability, and short-term disability. For $18,000, at the bottom of that particular column,
mm-hmm.
that would likely go away because IMRF
covers that.
That's right.
So that could technically be put up into the IMRF?
Yeah, so we'd see about a 10% increase at 8.12.
Okay.
Can I ask a question? You said you have 44 full-time employees and then there's an additional 8. Are we talking additional 8 full-time employees or 8 employees who are now working 30 hours?
8 employees who are working 30 hours or more per week on average.
Okay, so you're not anticipating more than 8 people? I mean, I thought there was a time when we talked about hiring, and when we went through this retirement package offer or whatever, that we were going to hire people at 29 and under to make sure that we wouldn't increase benefits. So is that a plan still or no?
Generally, that's what we're doing for part-time employees. These employees have transcended that period of time, basically,
mm-hmm.
we're here before we had that plan.
So they're kind of grandfathered.
So
yeah, and it's illegal, actually, to say we're in danger of offering you health care. So now we're going to cover your hours. So we couldn't do anything about that.
I was just wondering,
because
with
the
all
government will come in.
Part-time people, you have the numbers only 8. Okay, that's great. All right, then I have a question about the IMRF being at $221,000 for $2 million in salaries.
It's actually $2,733,000.
Okay, is that the salary that includes the 15 employees who could go back and buy?
Yes.
It does. Okay, and then so that's it. Not 8%. That's at 13-some%.
Wasn't that for one year?
No, I think you're
8.2 is without buying their years. If they buy their years, it goes up to 13.2.
And that would be for the next year.
If everybody buys all of their past service,
mm-hmm.
in 2 years, that rate will increase to 13.7%.
Right. And
but that was and for one
at
year
the current, excuse me, at the current salary level, covered salary level of $2,733,000, that's $375,000. It's 74 and change.
And then
it's actually in the presentation. That
and then also on the horizon is the fact that IMRF didn't do so well, so they will be increasing their percentages. So we won't even be paying, what is this, 8.2? That we think we're going to pay next year, it'll be even higher.
I don't understand. Oh, 8.12. In 2 years, it'll likely be higher.
Shouldn't we be having that discussion when we discuss that?
Well, no, we're talking about how much the budget may go up.
I think what would be wise to do, because as I understand it, the board plans to pass the tentative budget and appropriation ordinance I believe it would be prudent to increase this number to, I'd say $250,000, just as a placeholder, to give the board enough room to discuss and fully vet the choices for the retirement plan, and not have it be a last-minute raise when the board actually passes the final budget and appropriation ordinance. So, you know, that's the counsel I can offer, and then we can answer all the other questions about rate increases sometime.
Well, I was wondering, since IMRF is costly and it will affect all of the Niles residents, could we possibly have that added to the upcoming election and see how it fares with all the taxpayers before we even make this decision?
You mean have a referendum?
No, we have to pass the budget.
We can pass the budget, but we don't need to jump into IMRF next year.
Okay, that's a different discussion.
That's between the assets.
Right now, we're discussing the budget, and if we should allow a little extra in there or not.
Okay, $250,000. I would think for a placeholder, that's a good idea. And again, it's just a placeholder, it's no decisions made. But that's, does anybody else have?
Placeholder shouldn't be in the budget.
It could be the $221,000, it could be, you know.
Oh, and as far as utilities, oh, sorry, I'm out speaking.
I think we should finish that discussion first.
I'm just thinking, if, you know, I don't know if we're, what, what's gonna happen in IMRF or not, but if we did that, it would seem like, wouldn't we also at the same time reduce the amount that we are currently putting, putting into deferred cap, which is, are we requiring employees under any, come here?
Well, you didn't change that yet. You didn't change the salary part, is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
Where they were taking it a salary, you've not voted on that yet. You've just declared your intention of doing that.
Our intentions, we didn't technically.
We went around the table, it was a straw poll that said that we don't, you know, no board member likes that.
Right, yeah, right.
Right, so that would be gone, and then, so would it be called deferred comp any longer?
It would certainly be optional deferred comp if people wanted to do that.
Right, right. And then the other line item would be the $18,000, but get there. So actually, we wouldn't need the $250,000 because we have the other $18,000 there.
Well, the way I see it is that you kind of have some choices with the deferred comp or whatever you want to call this line. You can leave it exactly as it is now, in which case it would cost $182,000 next year. Or you can take that 7.5, which is so much lower than all of the other libraries, and at least try to get a little closer to what all of the other libraries are doing, which you would want to raise, to have enough room in the budget to be able to do that, or alternatively, look at IMRF. So those are, to me, are the three options. Leave it the same, raise the percentage, or go with IMRF.
Right, because the other percentage was like 9.5, 10, correct?
Well, that was the next, that was the nearest one.
Right, it was the next lowest. Yeah, the second to lowest, right.
So, you know, I would like to see you put, build enough headroom into the budget to be able to raise it at least something, because I feel like we're not very competitive where we are. So that would be my preference, just to clarify.
And the key here is that document that you plan to vote on tonight is the tentative ordinance. I think it would be a shame to have a lower number in the tentative ordinance and then have the public hearing on the lower number. And then at, you know, before we pass it, before you pass the budget and appropriation ordinance, finalize it, you increase the number to account for an action that you've taken. So I think that it's much easier to explain if you reduce the number, because, you know, possibly says we've included everything that we've thought of, every possibility, and after serious consideration, we figured out that their number should be lower, and then we reduce it, than if we go in the opposite direction.
And it's really the truth, because we haven't yet all the facts put toward, you know, put forth, and we still, you know, need to make those decisions.
Right. Well, I don't mind that, I get us a placeholder with the understanding that we still have to thoroughly vet the vote on it at a later date. But I do think, you know, letting the public know this is a maximum amount of our budget, it might not be this much that we actually spend, is the best idea.
Patty?
I think we should leave it as a placeholder, because we still have the one other thing we were gonna discuss. We wanna be competitive with other libraries, we know what we're doing now isn't. And like they said, if we decide this is too much, we can lower it.
But we don't have to spend it all.
We don't have to spend it all, basically, yes.
Again, just like every other budget item, it's a placeholder. Tim?
I'm okay with putting it at 250.
Thank you, Ellen.
I'm actually all about factual numbers, so I'm not a placeholder person, so it's not something I would be in agreement with.
Well.
I think when we work on our budget, we should determine at that time what we're doing with that.
Well, we're still in flux and we're still in undecided, and we're working.
Well, I think.
We're working towards it.
I think we're in a position to know whether we can afford things or not. It's not in flux, it's just, it's money, and we need to, I just think we should take it more seriously, but by all means, whatever you want to do.
We're taking it very seriously, but there's more people, so let's like put it in for the 250.
If I may, when we put the schedule for the budget together, we held out as an objective to pass the budget and have it adopted prior to the start of the new fiscal year. At that time, when we made the presentation, we discussed the fact that there would be, at times in the budget, estimated numbers, placeholders, if you will. So the way to not have placeholders is to pass the budget in August, you know, which is probably the last, maybe we can go to, no, fourth Tuesday in September is the last time that, you know, that we can actually pass the budget. At that point in time, I dare say that we would know what many of these numbers were. We'd know exactly what the group health was going to be, because we'll have the pricing, we'll have the commitments from the employees who want to take it or don't want to take it. We'll know what the board's desire is vis-a-vis retirement compensation and what that looks like. But if the, you know, if the objective is to pass it prior to the end of the fiscal year, then we have to work with some estimates.
Okay, thank you, Ben. My objective is when you work on a budget, you're prepared with final figures. That's what it's all about, and you meet your budget beginning of your new fiscal year. I've never sat in on a budget committee meeting where we just guess, but thank you for that.
Okay, next page.
Well, before we jump, we're looking at utilities.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we've talked about electricity and it's all over the board. And I see the annual budget is 100,000, so we're leaving it at 100,000 for next year. I know you've said numerous times that you've contacted Edison or maybe some other utility companies about rates. I'm starting to think that the issue is maybe not the rate of our electricity, but actually what is causing the cost of electricity to rise. And have we done any evaluations on our equipment to determine that?
Yes. We use a bulb in several applications called a metal halide bulb, which does burn electricity at a faster rate. If we did switch to an LED, a light emitting diode bulb, we would save money. However, there are quality issues and there are cost issues on the conversion.
Okay.
So the quality issues are that most of the LED lights that are commercially available cast a blue light, which is very undesirable in our setting. Might be a good application for outside, and we've been testing different bulbs on the inside, but have not made a determination. In other applications around the building, we can actually install light fixtures that'll read the ambient light, and if the ambient light is too low, we'll actually fire and turn the fixtures on.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, that's a very expensive conversion to do, and the payback is well beyond 10 years.
Okay.
So.
So has it even worked?
Yeah, so typically when you're doing something like this, you're looking for a payback in, you know, 3 to 5 years. When it gets to 5 to 7, it becomes questionable. Really beyond 7, it's, you know, it's a huge expense that, you know, you're really not ready to take on.
Okay. Actually, what I had in mind were more like the 3D printer and all the other equipment we bought. Because since we've gotten all of this equipment, our electric bill is skyrocketing. And I know that 3D printer runs constantly. Not sure what it's costing us. And then I think we have business people coming here, and they're able to bring in their own devices. I mean, I can't imagine that our electricity would go up this much and we can't figure out what are we doing.
Our electric bill in the most recent cycle was down 18% compared to others in the area that were only down like 12%.
I'm more concerned about how it jumped like 10,000 one period and we haven't even dropped. So what are we doing? I'm not thinking of light bulbs. I truly am concerned about
printers. But actually, Caroline, if you're looking through the whole actuals all the way from 2009 all the way through,
mm-hmm.
we're actually down, and it's been pretty consistent except for one.
Our electric bill was $100,000.
Yeah, and in 2009 it was 115,
okay,
and 100. I know.
Why not?
But this is,
way, I'm thinking a year ago.
But this is what
ago.
We do when
yeah,
you look at a budget. You look at the whole. You look at the whole line item.
It wasn't 2 years ago the construction.
Yes.
So that you really can't count on that 2012, 13.
Okay, but anyway, back to just more recently,
right,
jumped 10,000. And I was wondering
where
what caused
is it that you're saying
I don't
that it
see
jumped?
That.
No, we were at a board meeting and it
brought
jump, it up to you.
It'll jump $10,000 in a given month.
Mm-hmm.
And what they call that in the electrical business is summertime. When the chillers are running and when the fans are running, pretty constantly trying to keep up.
It wasn't summer, but that's okay. But anyway, back to our main
if the fall
whatever
is,
it's
if
called.
The fall is warm. And the same condition exists.
Have we done an analysis on the cost of running some of this new equipment?
Specifically, no. If you're looking to eliminate the equipment overall, you know, we can do that. But I don't. I'm looking at large numbers. I mean, if it costs $3 to run that every month, I don't. You know,
you really think that's all it costs to run that?
The makeup on does not use a ton of electricity.
Oh, I don't know. It makes all these things. Did you ever get any information when you purchased it? I mean, your electric bill is going up. It can't be.
It actually is very since in the past 4 years. I won't go back all the way. The past 4 years. Our budget item is exactly the same. They're all 100,000 all the way 4 years across.
Oh no, it was just from the previous budget.
It's the
meetings
same.
We
haven't upped
up
the budget at all. So
because we budgeted
99
last year.
Maybe it's for the whole year, okay?
But that's what we're doing here. We're doing the budget for the whole year.
Wow.
It's the same. For 4 years, it's the same.
I mean, the big difference that I see walking around the library is that practically every single person that's sitting here has their phone plugged into an outlet. And that's why we've put so many outlets in the construction, because
mm-hmm.
everybody's got their laptop plugged in.
Mm-hmm.
Some people are using both the laptop and the phone.
Right.
Into our
you mentioned they're bringing their printers in, too.
Well, one person does that, yes. That's just one person.
Sometimes it's battery operated, too.
Yeah.
Okay. I know we have a battery operated printer. But.
Before we leave that subject, let's beat this dead horse just a little bit more.
Okay.
Carolyn, if you look on page C25,
mm-hmm.
there's a chart that looks like this.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a 3-year comparison, month by month, of electrical usage.
Okay.
Not the billing, the electrical usage in kilowatt hours. And if you look, you know, some months the gray stripe is higher, some months the gray stripe is lower. It all depends on what the ambient temperature is outside, and other factors. I mean,
I just know that when we questioned this in the past, we weren't able to determine why it went up, so I just thought I'd ask, since it's not what you pay.
And I have more data now.
Awesome.
So I think that's going through everything, correct? Right? Through everything?
Yeah.
Okay, so then I just have two changes, same with you, correct?
Yeah.
Okay, so I have the consulting to decrease $10,000, and I have the deferred comp of increase of $67,069 to meet, make it the 250. Correct?
Yes.
Okay. So with those changes, do I have a motion to approve the tentative budget ordinance 16-01?
So moved.
Karen? Patty? Second? Okay, Cindy, please take a roll.
Patty?
Yes.
Carolyn?
No.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Kim?
Yes.
Would please, Susan, announce a hearing for Wednesday, June 15th, 2016, at 6:55 p.m.
I will.
Let's see. Unfinished business?
Declaring vacancy, so you have staff.
Hold on a second. Okay. All right, so, we asked the lawyer, and this is the information for the new trustee. The Board of Trustees of the Niles Public Library District has a vacancy in the Office of Library Trustee due to the resignation of Trustee Jeanette Matthias, effective April 21st, 2016. Under Illinois Library Law, this vacancy in the Office of Library Trustee will be filled by appointment by the remaining trustees under the next regular library election, which is the balance of Trustee Matthias' term. The board will be discussing how it intends to fill the vacancy at its next regular board meeting. Do I have a motion to formally declare a vacancy in the Office of Library Trustee effective April 21st, 2016?
So moved.
Ms. Karen? And Kara? Mm-hmm. Cindy, please take a roll.
Karen?
Yes.
Carolyn?
Yes.
Patty?
Yes.
Linda?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Okay, the next is public comments. Are there any public comments tonight? If there are, if you can grab this sheet, Cindy, I appreciate it. Okay, so the Niles Public Library District Board of Trustees encourages and welcomes public participation input. Anyone wishing to address the board during the part of the agenda must register, which they have. When addressing the board, speakers will be limited to 5 minutes per registered individual and 30 minutes overall. All speakers must maintain professional demeanor. Abusive, profane, frivolous, harassing, and or repetitive comments will not be permitted at my discretion, and I terminate the remarks of speakers who did not adhere to the Niles Public Library District's policy 3.28, public participation and comment at board meetings. Our first speaker is Chris Hemmingstead. Chris? Thank you.
I'm sorry to
say that.
How do you spell Ryan,
right? I'm sorry.
So we stand here. Good evening to the board, everybody. Thank you for doing the job for the budget. It's a lot of hard work, and I understand that. So there's a lot of work that goes into it. I'll make some comments on that. But earlier, we had the presentation by Donna Fletcher. I want to find out who wrote the RFI for that. I mean, is it because you're asking for planning service, strategic planning? Did the library, somebody in here say, hey, these are what we require, the RFI, the information that we want, and did they go out to bid? And then what committee decided that this person's going to be, you know, who we want to look at? Because it seemed like you were going to vote on somebody tonight based upon one proposal. There was not, like, you know, a bunch of bidders. I mean, that was what you guys were voting on earlier, you know, to accept this person or not, but you tabled it. So who all else bid on this proposal, or did you guys create the proposal saying, hey, this is what we expect? Was there an RFI? The other thing about that is you want to go out there and do 1,000 surveys, 500 internally, 500 externally. Who's going to do the external? I mean, you're looking for volunteers. What's the liability for the library if they use volunteers and somebody goes outside and we start talking, so they get hit by a car. Is the library liable for insurance because they're doing a survey for the library? All these questions by not using staff. I'd like to see, if you're going to use staff, they're $34,500. What is the real cost to the library when you start using staff and volunteers? Because that's not a real number, to $34,500. they're processing information, you guys are doing all the legwork. So that's one thing. The budget, you guys are working on everything else. I would make a recommendation. I mean, the budget just finished in the Village of Niles. They have a budget workshop. Everybody's seen it. Maybe set up something like what they do, a budget workshop, where you go through these items. It's not just an appropriation, tentative appropriation. They do a workshop based upon all the information. The questions get asked just like this, but I mean, some of the stuff is very disorganized. And the budget also, instead of the Village of Niles, as a resident, I have the opportunity, if I wanted to purchase, which the reason of purchasing the budget is to pay for the copy of it. They'll do it for me, and I will get a detailed line item. What the trustee Driblek was asking for, they have that. So the thing is, what you have here is a summarization, but you could go into each department and find out a detailed line item, and that is available for citizens if you want to get that printed out also. So it's not something that's massive, but it's something that maybe you could implement eventually down the road as a detailed line item, so year to year you know what you're spending it on. And you know, it doesn't go all the way to like pennies or anything like that, but you could go from year to year saying, we need so much programs. We ran 10 last year. This year we're running 9. This year we want to run 11. And it tells why we want to do the increase. But there is a detail line item for that appropriation. So it's an opportunity. Watch the budget workshop that they did inside the Village of Niles. You can see, go get maybe a budget from them and get the detail line item. You'll see exactly what is expected of everybody. And this way you could understand that you really don't have any detail here. And as a citizen, I mean, I came here to the budget meeting and everything else. I wish there was a PowerPoint. I could see this on the screen. I'm just listening to what you had. I had nothing to follow. And it should have been gone, and there should have been some type of sequence. It was very disorganized. So I hope that, I understand there's a lot of work to it. But the thing is, I think it could just be done better. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, next speaker is Bob
Zaleski. That's great.
I'd just like to inform everybody that the state of Illinois has gone from the second position to number one position. We are now the highest tax, property tax state in the country. So we have that great honor, and that's what it is, because that's what we're doing, is spending a lot of money on government. A lot of money on the library, a lot of money across the street. They're giving out raises. You guys are giving out bonuses. I don't know where this is going to end. But I have several houses for sale on my block. Part of the reason over there is because of taxes. Some of the guys, Vince, he stood over here. He says, you guys raise my taxes, I'm moving. He's got the most beautiful house on the block over there. It's going for nearly $1 million. I wish somebody would buy it. He's got a lot across the way. Been for sale for over a year. Has not sold. You sit there, you drive through the streets of Niles over here. You see businesses closing. Myers is closing. We're losing revenue, but yet we're spending more than ever before. As far as, like you mentioned, the referendum, I back you up on that. I second it. We're spending, we want to spend $35,000 to have a firm to talk to 1,000 people to find out what the people in the Village of Niles want. Why not put it on a referendum, put it to a vote? They did it across the street. They said, do you want these services? Should we continue the teen center, what's all the other centers that we had over there? And then the village voted, and they said yes, and I accept that. I voted no. I didn't like that they clumped everything together. I think you should take a look at every service individually. If you can afford it, you fund it. If you can't, it's got to go. So I do like the idea of putting it to a vote with the referendum. The couple that you had over here, I don't know, I walked out and I asked them a pretty simple question, about what this would cost, what it cost other libraries, a high and a low. They couldn't even give me a number. They couldn't even give me one single number. They couldn't answer a lot of questions that I heard over here. So I don't have a lot of faith in this firm over here. So I think maybe you should be looking at interviewing some other people, as Chris said. That's about it. That's going to cover it. Oh, I got one other thing. If you have a vacancy open over here, we have a candidate in the room. I'd like to nominate Mark Giddings. I think he gets along with the board. I don't know if he would take the position, but he would be a good addition to the library board. Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. Okay. Next last but not least.
Last but not.
Introduce yourself. Oh, sorry.
I'm David Carabota, 84 Nano Council Niles. I just want to echo the words of Chris Anushik and Bob Zalesny, who are longtime residents of the Village of Niles. They're also business owners and operators, and they've got their hand on the pulse of our local economy, as well as the reference to our state economy. I heard the word quiet tonight, and that's what this is about. What you're hearing from Chris and from Bob is what a lot of people are saying and a lot of people are thinking, but they're being quiet. They're quiet because either they're afraid of government, they're quiet because they're going to be told to be quiet if they speak up. If they speak up with these problems, maybe they're not using quite the right tone. Maybe the wording can be different. Maybe they're not good at oratory. But you're hearing from these people, and that's great. And you're also looking at the focus here is to try to operate a wonderful library, but is it within 2016? These people that we saw tonight, they're not in the 2016 mode. But neither are these budgets in this 2016 mode. We cannot do what we did 20 years ago, although it's admirable. It's admirable what you're trying to do, but money is not there. What we should be talking about is taking a $6.3 million budget for 60,000 people using a local library and seeing if we can cut that back. One penny of every dollar. And that's where your comments come in. I'm so glad they do. Let's try to bring it down. One penny per dollar. We're going to lose Niles to a number of people that want to live here. But it's being built up in such a manner that everything's beautiful and nice, but just not affordable. And people are just not going to be able to stay. And these buildings and these spaces will be empty. Are we going to really turn our Niles Library into the financial elephant that it seems to be with a $100,000 electric bill to begin with? How do we bring that down? We don't do it by bringing in a survey for five, that's going to go on for 5 months, at a budget of $34,000, plus utilizing all the staff and saying, well, gee, maybe we'll use volunteers. That really even shouldn't be, those people shouldn't even be here, okay? We have to adjust our attitude, we have to adjust our focus. Welcome to 2016. Thank you.
I missed one other point. The other point is, you said that you'd be in favor of raising the people, the percentage, like 2%, 2.5%. I'll work with you. I'll go along with you on that.
Is there any other?
But IRMA, no.
Under other, I just wanted to mention that a very, very lovely lady passed away a few days ago. Her name is Helen Sparks, and she was a wonderful volunteer for the library, did many things for us, and they made the library one of the beneficiaries of donations. So when people came directly from the memorial service and made donations today. So I just wanted everybody to be aware.
Yeah,
that
is really, really
lovely.
It was
lovely.
Really
the
service
was beautiful.
As much as possible. And someone who does something like that is, you know, the family. I hope we thank the family in some way.
Yes, certainly.
Thank you, person. And then we'll say, a thank you note based on for the donations.
Can you send the family flowers or something?
There's no budget for sending anything like that. We're not allowed to do that. But
can we open up the budget process
again?
Yeah, I don't know. But, you know, so I think they sent
them kind of like giving and then we're giving it. Yeah. And,
I think a letter of kindness and
thank you. And
do we ever specify like what we do? They specify like something that they wanted specifically.
Sometimes people do, but they did
right.
Not.
Oh, okay.
It's like the
okay.
We see how much it was.
Well, the Friends of the Library. Helen was also a member of the Friends of the Library.
It was a representative on yesterday's awakening to the mass.
Yes, but they also dedicated last Friday's Shakespeare performance to Helen, which was very nice.
That was wonderful. Yes. Which I heard was amazing.
Yes, it was.
Yeah. Special. Yes. So. Okay.
Thank you. So I will entertain a motion to adjourn the meeting.
Do we need to discuss more about the process that we're going to use to...
Well, we could do that at the next meeting, but we can't... The one thing I could say is, if anybody has anyone that... I'm sorry, that's my time.
Process for...
For Jeanette's open spot, bring anyone that you might have any ideas that might like to, you know, be for that open spot. Maybe bring a short bio of the person, then we can decide if we want to appoint, maybe what time, you know, when. I know we have a lot of things happening right now with the strategic plan, and then that person, if they came in, they wouldn't know any of the prior of the pensions that we might have. Well, that's a board decision.
I don't know what you're thinking.
Right.
I would think application would be...
Yeah, I mean, well, I think we have talked, do we want applications, do we want to have interviews, do we just want to appoint? I think that's, think about it until our next board meeting, and think about anyone that you would maybe want to recommend, and talk about it then, at the next meeting.
Oh, May, right, it's April.
Because I think it's kind of, you know, this just kind of came about us pretty quickly.
Mm-hmm.
Now that we know what we technically don't have to fill it, I wouldn't recommend that. I think that we should fill it, depending, but on what we have to do. I think we, again, we should, you know, take a poll, but let's just focus on it at the next meeting, and we'll put it on the agenda. And
we could, I'm sorry.
Yeah.
Maybe we can consider applicants that have experience in a lot of the things we're going for.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know, but
right.
That would make it a...
I mean, I know a few people have ideas of, you know, people that they know, and recommendations, and we'll kind of take it from there. But, you know, I think we all just have to have our input, and see, I mean, it's a big decision. It is a year, so it's kind of a nice, you know... Kind of jump in, let's see how it is, you know. It's a great kind of open spot for a year to kind of test the waters. It's kind of
and
nice.
And see if it's something they really want to.
Right.
Jump
I think
on.
It's a great opportunity for someone. You know, but so that's kind of what we saw. If you have any recommendations, I would say bring them to the meeting, a little bio, and then we'll decide whether the applications for them, you know, and appointment. And maybe a timeline. Okay. All right. Anything else? Sam, is your question?
Yeah.
Okay. all right. So, motion to adjourn the meeting. Tim and Patty.
Patty, sorry.
Whatever.
Aaron,
by the way, I wanted to tell you, Lance Maryland.
Yes.
Yeah, it takes a bottle of water.
Yes.
I do have a copy of information for you. I just forgot to bring it tonight.